In the repair shop today, a much-loved toy lies in tatters.
That is quite serious, isn't it?
Yeah.
So how are you going to fix this? You've got no reference. There's nothing there.
And Brenton's search for some precious metal leads him to a fellow expert's stash.
Have you got any bigger diameter brass bar? That might be the piece. Failing that, that might be the piece. That is the piece. I can turn it down from that.
First to arrive at the repair shop clutching a cherished possession are Roger and Francis Livett.
Hello, how are we doing?
Doing well. How about yourself?
I'm very good, actually.
I'm Roger.
I'm Jay.
Jay, nice to see you. And you're Francis.
They've brought with them a piece of wartime history that survived against the odds.
A music box. A rather battered music box.
OK. I know, just... Steve, we've got a music box here, mate.
This job calls for the skills of music box maestro Steve Kember.
Steve's the man.
Yes, Steve is the man.
Steve, nice to see you. Nice to see you.
Hello.
Hello. This poor fella was involved in a bomb in September 1940.
Hold on, let's rewind it a minute. What do you mean involved in a bomb?
It was in a house near Beckenham that in 1940 a bomb landed on the house. This was in there as well, hence this damage.
Like all things in the Second World War, you were either lucky or unlucky. My grandmother, her two sons and an aunt were in the house at the time.
The bomb destroyed the family home, killing everyone inside. Fortunately, Roger's mum, Charlotte, wasn't in the house at the time. She had moved out a few years earlier after getting married.
That's my grandfather. That's my grandmother. That's John. That's Philip, and that's me mum. The family she grew up with, the family she expected to see for years and years, had been taken away from her in just one afternoon. It was something that hurt mum all her life.
The family music box was one of the only possessions to survive the fatal blast.
The music box was kept up in the loft. And then sometime in 1956, 57, somewhere around there, it did come down and it was played. And it was fascinating to me. The memory of it being played is still very vivid. I can still see that music box in the bay window of Mum and Dad's house. But it was played for literally just two or three days and then put back again. And I believe that was because it hurt Mum too much to see it there. There in that music box, I have something that they have touched, they have listened to. It does bring a connection to a family which I wish I had known, but I'm afraid I never did. So this means a hell of a lot to me.
I can understand just the history to it. What would you like us to do to this?
If possible, I'd like you to make sure that's safe to play. What worries me more than anything else is it hasn't been looked at or serviced ever. Obviously, the glass bit.
Yeah.
I haven't got the other bit of that. If possible, if you could make the lid fit again, that would be absolutely fantastic.
Okay.
But one thing I do ask, can we leave as much of the scars and bruises as possible? Because I think that's part of it.
Yeah.
To me, that...
And that's part of your family history,
yes,
right
that's
there.
The history
I'm so
of
pleased
it, yeah.
you said that, because... it's sort of a monument to what happened.
Yes.
And you don't want to sort of
Certainly
remove
not.
Its history.
Well, it's things that they would have touched. Yeah. And, you know, if you make it too clean, they wouldn't have touched it.
Yeah.
And that's
And they won't be
I'm
there
like.
Anymore.
No.
The approach I would take, if it were mine, was I would do the best job possible on the mechanism.
Please, yes.
It ought to be restored back to how it was so that the performance is as good as it
Yes,
can be,
that'd be great.
If,
yeah.
that, if that's acceptable to you.
Please, yes.
And the outside, the approach is more of one of conservation.
Yes.
Rather than
I certainly don't want to
restoration.
Look yes. Thank you very, very
is that
much.
All right?
If you could do that, that would be absolutely
we
brilliant.
Will do.
That'd be fantastic.
Okay. Yeah?
Yeah. If that's possible, that would be fantastic.
It's very possible. It's in safe hands.
Jay, thank you very much indeed.
No, thank
that's
you
lovely.
For bringing it along. Thank you, bud.
Thank you.
All right.
And Steve, thank you very much.
This is a quite profound, really. This is a symbol of one of the most sort of horrific events in the 20th century. So we've got to take care of it, really.
This is like family history that's in here.
So I'm going to take the big bit.
Yeah.
You take the little bit.
Yeah, don't trip.
I won't trip at all. Get it over to your desk,
Let's go.
Right.
The music box in its current state, it's battered, it's beaten up, but it's part of the family. To get it so that it works, but still has the same patina, for the want of a better word, would be absolutely fantastic.
In order to determine the extent of the damage and which bits are missing, Steve will have to first dismantle the entire mechanism.
So we do.
We're making progress. We've got the mechanism just here. It looks pretty dreadful, to be honest, but don't worry. A lot of that is just dirt and grime.
Yeah, but you've taken all of that out of there, yeah?
I've taken... No. I've just taken that out of there. And these parts here...
You're showing off again, ain't you?
Yeah.
All right.
...are from my graveyard. And all these parts came from the same village that this was made in. Okay. The tune indicator, that's the original hand that was on there.
Yeah.
And I found a replacement. I've replaced it with an original one. You get a better solution to the problem if you replace it with an old part rather than making a replacement.
Yeah.
If we have a quick look at the cone.
Cool, blimey. There's a bit of fluff in between them.
There's
two,
a bit of fluff. We'll deal with the fluff.
All right, cool.
We've got the equipment. We have the technology to deal with the fluff.
I like your thinking.
Some of the items that enter the repair shop haven't just been handed down through generations. They've been lovingly crafted by a family member. Jonathan Tukes has a handmade heirloom for the attention of silversmith and metals expert Brenton.
Hi there.
Oh, hello.
I'm Brenton.
Hi, I'm Jonathan.
Nice to meet you. What have you brought me?
I've brought you some tongs from a set of fire irons that were made by my great-grandfather in his foundry in the Black Country.
So your grandfather made these?
My great-grandfather made these. And they've been in our family ever since.
They're really old then.
About 1880. In Dudley, in this time, there were lots of places making this. My great-grandfather had the foundry, but even his grandfather had a foundry on the same site. Okay. And we know that's been going since at least 1829.
The family foundry.
The family foundry.
Wow.
Yes.
These are fabulous.
Yeah, but unfortunately, the hinge has come apart. It's very annoying because when I put them out on my fireplace,
they fall a little jolt
and they'll fall apart.
And these are brass?
These are solid brass.
Yes.
This has an iron or metal core. Yes.
And are these all the parts?
These are all the parts of the tongs.
Well, because it's brass, it's quite soft.
Yes.
And it will wear out in time, unfortunately.
Yes, and
I'm sure
happened.
When these were made, they weren't expecting them to last that long, so they've done really, really well.
Yes.
And the fact you've still got this is brilliant.
These fire tongs mean a lot to me because they were made by my great-grandfather, but our family's manufacturing history goes back to at least 1829. It'd be nice to have them in their proper state.
They need a new thread cutting on there. So I'll have to remove that and probably put a new piece of brass in there. And then they need a matching thread in there so that that will screw together. Quite complicated, so I'm going to go and give it a go and see what happens.
Outside in the metal workshop, Brenton sets about his task.
So what I've got to do with these is replace the thread in here.
Brenton's got a stash of threaded brass rods in his toolkit, so he tries them for size.
No, that's going to be too small. I've got a bigger bit here. That should do it. Nope, that's too small as well. So these two bits I've got are no use. So I'm going to need to get some brass from somewhere.
First port of call is clockmaker Steve, with his collection of odds, ends and offcuts.
Steve, you know the fire tongs that I'm repairing?
Yeah.
I brought some brass from my toolbox, but they're too small. Have you got any bigger diameter brass?
Do you want a thread?
I can make the thread.
You don't want a big thread?
You got a big thread?
Actually, no, I haven't.
Oh, well, I'll make my own then.
Oh, here we go.
How big?
That might be the piece. That might be the piece. Failing that, that might be the piece. That is the piece. I can turn it down from that. If I could borrow those two,
yeah, of course you can.
Probably have about an inch of one of them, that'd be brilliant. Thank you very much.
Okie dokie.
Thanks, Steve.
Brass successfully scavenged. Brendan must now cut it down to size.
So I've got my piece of brass and a lathe. It's just over 8.5 millimetres. I've got to make it 7.9 millimetres to fit, so I've got to turn a bit off it to make it a bit smaller.
Steve Kember is rescuing a music box that miraculously survived a World War II bomb during the Blitz.
I'll give this a bit of a rinse.
He's giving the entire mechanism a complete overhaul.
Having never actually restored a music box that's been bombed before, I'm quite happy with that.
Meanwhile, Jay assigns the task of repairing the music box case to furniture restorer Will.
Hey there, Will. Got a little present for you.
An actual present?
Of course not, it's a job. So, it's a music box. It's been in the war, and the family's house got bombed.
So this damage is from the bombing?
Yeah, from the bombing.
Gosh.
Steve's working on the actual mechanism in there.
OK.
What we need you to do is fix that.
So it's missing a piece, and you don't have the missing piece?
Don't have the missing piece.
OK.
And then inside here, we've got this glass, if you can repair that. What Roger wants is not to be fully restored. There's a lot of history in there, and he doesn't want to lose it.
Don't want to lose it.
So the worst thing you could do is get rid of all those scratches.
OK. So it's a sympathetic restoration due to the situation.
But it's even more sympathetic in the sense that
we
don't want any of this to go.
OK.
No damage to be hidden. The damage is to be celebrated. Does that make sense?
OK. Yeah, that makes sense.
All right, I'll leave it with you.
Next to arrive, Anne Bailey and her grandson, Elliot. They have brought in an old friend who met with an unfortunate accident. They're hoping he can be revived by soft toy restorers Amanda and Julie.
So, what have you got for us?
We have something from my childhood.
Right.
Oh, dear. So when did this happen?
I'm fairly sure that he was damaged by my Irish setters. The setters were puppies.
Yeah, that's what they do.
Silly things.
Yeah. We see it all the time. So can you tell us a little bit more about him?
Yes, of course. I was given him by a person called Arthur Raskey, who was a comedian who lived in our village. And he went, go, 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 into my pram. And I went,
as you would.
And I screamed and screamed and screamed, because I was only about one. And he said, oh, I don't think she likes me. So he went away, and a couple of days, weeks later, he came back with this and gave it to me. With the hope that I wouldn't scream at him again.
Yeah. And did you?
No, I didn't think I did.
Oh, that's nice. Fantastic. Okay.
Does
lovely.
He have a name?
No, he doesn't.
Oh, dear. No,
we like to name them all, you know. I think it's time to think of a name.
Yes, maybe we should.
Well, he's absolutely lovely. He's going to be quite a challenge.
Yes.
Can I just see, I think, where your thumb is? Yeah, I've noticed there's a wire sticking out here. Do you remember whether he used to stand?
I just wondering. Can't remember.
I just wondering. This is part of what would have been like an internal sort of skeleton that we might find some more bits. We'll investigate and see what's going on in there. So that's not a problem. We've worked on similar lambs, which were made by a British company called Merrythought. But we haven't seen one exactly like this.
He certainly shows signs of being a quality toy.
Yeah.
We can tell that because he's made in quite a number of pieces.
Yes.
Every piece that is made is another sort of process in his manufacture.
Uh-huh.
A cheaper toy or lamb in this case would have been literally two-sided, really.
Mm.
But he shows all the signs of something of better quality. And I would say we're looking at sort of late 30s, perhaps early 40s. I mean, once we get well into the war years, the manufacture of toys was not important.
Yeah, we should be able to sort him out for you.
That would be wonderful.
No, you're welcome. Of course he can have a buttercup. Yes, that's not a problem.
I remember him having a yellow buttercup in his mouth.
But the main thing you want is to see him with a body.
Absolutely, yes. He needs to be cuddled again.
Absolutely.
Thanks for bringing him in.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
There's something missing.
Definitely. We can do it.
Yeah, we can. We've got enough there to go on. I think that we can...
We can rebuild
him. We can.
Him. We will.
Right.
Go on.
Come on, then.
I'll bring his hoof.
Okay.
Emotionally, it's very important to me because it takes me back to my very young childhood in a tiny village in Oxfordshire. The lamb has never left my side. I've always had it with me, and it's very precious. It would be great to get it back into the state that it was when I had it when I was a little girl.
Okay. We've now got time to have a look at him.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Well...
Now, that is quite serious, isn't it?
Jay,
yeah.
So how are you going to fix this? You've got no reference. There's nothing there.
We have got a bit of a clue in that we've got... If we turn him this way... So there's a tummy panel here.
Right.
OK, that's still intact. From here, we can kind of... We can see how fat the body was.
OK.
Should we just hold him up?
That would have dropped down a bit.
The style of this era, his head would have been... up here.
Right.
And it would have been quite short in the body and very long in the leg.
So
we're trying to look at
it. So where would the body be? Would it be about there?
Yeah.
You know you could rebuild that.
Like. Yeah.
But there's a lot of work here because it isn't just about doing that. We've got to completely dismantle him.
This seam here will undo all of this. And the tail and the head will come off.
Right, yeah.
And I will work on making a new pattern so that we can rebuild his body.
OK.
And also, I don't know if you can see here, Jay, there's a little piece of wire here. It's suggesting to us that he had a wire frame. His owner doesn't remember that.
OK.
Certainly, these sort of toys from this era were very often wired. But it would have helped them to stand and have their heads held high.
So you're going to get that wire to attach to all the other
We'll probably replace
that's quite
that.
Dangerous,
yeah,
isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, that will come out and we'll replace it.
So this is going to take quite a while to do, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very intricate, this one.
I'm going to be off to do some painting.
All right. Thanks, Jay.
Cheers, Jay.
See you later.
Bye.
Outside, Brenton's made his brass screw for the 140-year-old fire tongs. He now needs to create a new thread so that he can attach them together again.
So I've got my tap, which is larger than the hole we've got in here. So we'll cut this thread in here.
In order to get his cutting tool far enough into the piece, he must remove the brass plate that sits on the back of the screw.
It would make my life a lot easier if I can get the back plate off here. It means I can drill all the way through, and then it'll be easier for me to cut the thread. So I'm just going to try and lever that off. Brilliant. OK, that's got that off there. So I'm really pleased I managed to get this plate off here. I'm going to start cutting the larger thread in this piece. And this brass cuts really nicely. It's nice and soft. You go half a turn forward and then you go half a turn back. So I'm just going to solder this plate that we took off earlier back on now that I've cut the thread. So we're just applying a gentle bit of heat to this. I'm really happy that soldered really, really nicely. That plate is now stuck back onto the handle of the tongs, how it originally was. I've got to polish this up, and this bit is now finished.
Back inside the workshop, Steve has reached a critical point in the repair of the bomb-damaged music box. He's given all the components a thorough clean, Now he needs to get it singing again.
We're getting serious now. This is the cylinder. It's had all the oil removed. Now, we've prepared the clockwork mechanism, and that's all good. If we have a look along the pins on the cylinder, there are a significant number of them that are bent. That one's bent forward, and so the timing of the note will be wrong. It will be late. If they're either bent to the right or to the left, we'll end up with some gibberish. And these deficiencies can be heard, and they'll drive the owner a little bit crazy after a while, or they'll be slightly underwhelmed by the final result. It is very likely that some of these will snap, but you don't have to worry about that because you can lose sort of, say, up to 5% of these pins and it won't noticeably degrade the music. It's much better to have a note that's missing than it is playing badly or in the wrong place.
While Steve continues the painstaking process of straightening the 8,000 pins, Will is tackling the section of the box's lid lost in the bomb blast.
I have actually salvaged the straw front, which was going in a skip, and I think that this would be perfect if I can cut a section out of there and splice it onto the front of this. However, when you look at it like that, you can actually see that the top is actually slightly domed. You can actually see the gap in the outside, which is going to be a bit of a problem for me because the only bit that I have to replace it is flat.
That's pretty well finished for the pin straightening part of the procedure. Now we're going to produce some music. We'll give it a go and we'll see what we got. Give it a wind. Well, as you can hear, it's not that great. We're playing a bit of one tune and a bit of the other. The cylinder is clearly not aligned properly with the tips of the comb.
The cylinder's pins play the notes of 10 different tunes, but if they're not perfectly in line with the teeth of the comb they strike, the chosen tune will be either incomplete or jumbled up with another.
Let's have another go. Oh, that's lovely. We've got gibberish now. Imagine somebody playing the piano and somebody sneaks up and shifts the piano one key width to the left or the right, so you're playing all the wrong notes in all the right places, and that's what we got here.
Fortunately, over on the carpentry bench, Will's having more luck shaping the new wood to match the original section.
It might look like I'm being quite forceful with this plane. However, there's a lot of excess wood that needs to be shaved down. And if I just used a file or sandpaper, I'd be there for days. So the pressure is really on. I don't want to do any more damage to the original top, but I need to almost shave so close that I get a nice, even surface with the new piece of wood. I'm about to veneer the top of the box. Usually when restoring a piece of furniture, I like to make it look as good as it did before it had any damage. But with this, I'm going to try to preserve the fact that the front of the lid had been lost in the explosion. So even though I will be veneering this bit here, I probably won't put the stringing in around the sides. This veneer has an adhesive on the other side. So when you run over it with a warm iron, it heats up the glue on the other side and it will soften. And as it cools, it'll set again, thus gluing the veneer to the surface.
Back outside in the metalwork area, Brenton wants to get the components of the antique fire tools gleaming before he puts the pieces back together.
All that's left for me to do now is just to polish this handle up where I've been soldering, and then we can give it back to Jonathan. And as you can see, that comes up really nicely, so I've just got to work on the rest of this handle, get all of these marks off here that are a result of me heating it up, and then it'll be fine to give back to Jonathan. It's the moment of truth. Let's see if it goes together, and more importantly, stays together. Right. I think Jonathan will be very pleased with that. That is like new.
The Tongs have been in Jonathan's family for 140 years, but they haven't been working for the last 40. Now he's back to reclaim a piece of his family's manufacturing past.
Jonathan.
Yeah, hello again, Vincent.
Nice to see you.
I'm hoping you've got something nice to show me.
Do you remember what you gave me?
I certainly remember what I gave you, which was a pair of fire tongs. They were rather sadly in two bits.
It was a pair, wasn't it?
Well, it was a pair because it was two bits, and I'm really interested to know whether you've been able to fix them for me.
Well, would you like to see them?
I'd love to see how
let's reveal what you've got under here.
My goodness, they're a lot more shiny than they were before, and they look to be in one piece. Dare I see if they open and shut?
You may.
I may, right. They haven't fallen apart, which is lovely. They open and shut. That's really good. I'm really keen to know how you've actually done the fixing.
Okay, well, if you want to take it apart for me.
If I take it apart, right. Well, this is the knob that unscrews.
Correct.
And so, you've somehow put a lovely new brass thread on that.
I've drilled the old thread out.
Yes.
And cut a new thread into it. This back bit came off,
oh, right.
Luckily, because then I could put my tap right through to do the
right.
thread. And then soldered that back on. And then...
It all screws together again.
Polished it all up. Yeah.
That's exactly what I was hoping you'd be able to do something like that.
Okay, well, they're back to new again.
That's really good. I'm really pleased.
Good.
Yes, I really am. It's so nice to have it working rather than just as something that clatters to the floor every time you touch it.
Well, I'm glad you're really pleased with them.
Yeah. Thank you ever so much, Brent.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.
Seeing these fire tongs restored has made me feel closer to my grandfather, who, of course, I knew, and my great-grandfather, who I didn't know. If they're looking down on us, they'd be pleased that the memory is kept alive, I'm sure.
Soft toy restorers Julie and Amanda are trying to rescue a childhood treasure. With a large portion of the lamb missing, the duo must rely on their years of experience to fill in the gaps.
We had three hooves and I had to make one. I'm hoping you won't be able to tell which is the one that I had to make.
At the moment, I am making the pieces that I need for the body out of felt. I've made myself a pattern, so I've now got the body filled in. So I know now, you know, what shape his body was, the insides of the legs and the tummy panel. Making them out of felt initially for two reasons. One, because I want to sort of do a dummy run just to make sure that I've got everything in proportion. And two, because I'm going to use this felt to line the pieces because we have sourced some fabulous fabric, but it is a little bit tad stretchy. So the felt is going to support it and give it a bit of stability.
But all of Amanda and Julie's hard work will be in vain unless they can work out a way to get this little lamb back on his feet again.
It looks a little bit crude, but he's going to have like an internal wired frame that's kind of bendable along his back here and up into his head to support his head. And that will allow the legs and things to be moved around a little bit. Little hoops.
He's actually going to be quite tall.
So we're quite excited now. We've got to that stage where, you know, we can actually start rebuilding him.
Now it's a case of completing the jigsaw puzzle. All of the lamb's existing pieces are stitched back together, ready to be joined by the brand new tummy section.
We've had to make things worse before we got better, and there really wasn't a lot of him to go on. So now we're at this stage, it's much more exciting for us. So it really is just a case now of us stitching away and getting him back into one piece.
Yeah, and hopefully Anne will be thrilled. She'll still be cuddly.
Yep.
Hold on, I can see sewing going on, and I said I've been practising my buttons.
That's fine, we've got a job for you.
Oh, is it?
We've been saving a job for you.
You can turn this leg, OK?
What do you mean, turn it inside out?
Well, it's already here, so now we want to
pull this through so that it looks like this.
Like that? So, like, pulling my socks on?
Yeah.
There you go.
So now the frame goes into...
Yeah.
The legs. That'll go down inside there.
Now it looks like a proper lamb.
To look like a lamb,
isn't it? I think that's quite cool.
We're getting there.
This is kind of where we're at.
So you know what? I did have my doubts.
Yeah, we know you did.
Yeah, you've got it all under control now, look.
Yeah,
it's that's not a problem. Oh, but this, oh, yeah, you've missed a bit. What about the leg?
Yeah,
it's a bit. You're gonna put that on?
Going on around here.
All right, OK. All right, that's cool.
You're welcome.
Meanwhile, Steve is fine-tuning the misfiring music box.
Got that one.
He spent hours meticulously making microscopic adjustments.
That's it.
Now it's back on song. Steve can replace any missing parts with spares from his personal collection of pre-loved music boxes, including a zither.
It's of a type that would have been fitted originally. It was even made in the same area.
The zither alters the musical tone of the box. It applies a hollow tube of tissue paper to the teeth of the comb, damping the sound and producing a plucked string effect.
This fits on the back. Oh, God. It's like a badly behaved child. It won't do what I want it to do. But we'll get there eventually. Right. So we've added our special effect. Let's see. Yeah, I'm happy with that. Yeah, that's all right, actually. As far as zithers go, I think that's quite successful.
Over on Julie and Amanda's workbench, the once disembodied toy lamb is being brought back to life.
We need to get on and get the stuffing in because he's looking a bit starved at the moment.
You have to kind of build it up. It's a bit like a brick wall, really. You can't start at the top and work down. That's better.
There we go.
See the shape now.
Got these?
Yeah. That's where it's got to go.
Yeah. Really pleased with how he's turning out. Finishing touch will be his buttercup, which we'll put back in his mouth, and we might even put a bow on him.
OK. We'll leave it at the back, because I think it looks nice on him, don't you?
It's been decades since Anne saw her childhood playmate in fine fettle.
Its front end and its back end were absolutely fine, except that it had lost its buttercup, I think, out of its mouth. But the middle section was totally and utterly just a bit of rag. It was looking very sorry for itself, so to be able to have it back to its original wonderful state will be super.
Hello.
Lovely to see you.
Come on over.
Oh, thank you. Oh, and this must be it, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful.
Are you ready to go for it?
Yeah. Wow, he's fantastic. Even with a blue ribbon.
Absolutely. Look at him.
Oh, wonderful. It's almost real, isn't it?
Yes, he does, yeah.
That is absolutely amazing. I just can't believe that you've managed to match the... Oh, you are.
I'm so happy. Give him a cuddle. Give him a... There you go. That's nice.
You're an absolute love. Even with your buttercup. Wow.
Oh, yeah, he's got his new buttercup.
New buttercup. And his little hooves, because one of the hooves was missing, wasn't it?
It was, yes.
Totally
just turn him over. We were able to take
a pattern from one of the original ones. We covered the other three.
Right.
Took the pattern off the original ones and made you a new one, so they all match nicely now.
No, that's super, because, you know, one foot missing was rather sad, wasn't it?
Yeah, yes. He wasn't standing well, was he?
But he has got a wire frame in
had
him
he?
Now.
Oh.
He would have had with the right. research that we did uh-huh. and that style and that era.
Right.
But this frame that's in him is not so rigid that you won't be able to pose him a little bit. Right. I mean, obviously with care.
Yeah, I will. Yes, I shall look after him lovingly this time. Oh, and you've cleaned him too.
Yeah, oh gosh, yeah, every piece was cleaned. Every single piece of him. We had to completely dismantle him and then work out, you know, the proportions of how his body would have been right. and everything. So, yes, and all of his original pieces are lined to right. strengthen them.
Munching buttercups. Perhaps we should have called him Buttercup.
There you go. We were wondering about a name.
Yes. Perhaps you can be a buttercup.
Oh, well, there you go. He's all yours.
Oh, wonderful.
Do enjoy him. Well, he's got a good few more years in him now.
He has, yes. He's lasted 74 years. So
we'll
he's
do another 74.
Yeah, another 74.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. You thank you so much.
It's our pleasure.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. I feel elated that he's got four little feet and a rubby tummy. And he's got a middle. And the buttercup is just like the crowning glory. It brings back childhood memories with my lamb.
Music box fanatic Steve is lovingly restoring a precious piece of family history. Crafting alongside him on the woodwork is Will, whose remit was to restore the case while retaining traces of its turbulent past.
Stevie.
Ah.
For you.
Lovely.
This is a strange one for me, because I'm used to...
You're used to precision craftsmanship, aren't
exactly.
you?
Exactly.
I think this is as they specified. So we got some of its original...
Some of its original...
...character, and he can... he's got a link with the event that...
had taken place,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Excellent. So that's good.
You look like you've done a great job with that.
Well, I have, I hope.
It looks great. I hope it's going to sound great.
It'll sing
exactly.
to us.
Exactly.
Yeah, OK.
Well, I'll leave you to put that in.
Thank you very much.
All right, matey.
Yeah, cheers. Bye. Right, let's see. It? Well, rather splendid, I think. Let's hope that Roger likes it and it'll be around to tell the story of his family for many generations to come.
This music box is the only link Roger has to the part of his family he never knew. But will it look and sound just as he remembers it when he was a child?
It was in a very bad state. The lid was broken, the outside was scarred, and certainly the mechanism had the best part of 70 years' worth of dirt all over it. So I'm really looking forward to seeing it. I can't tell you how much I'm looking forward to it.
Hello. Nice to see you again.
Oh, it's good to see
Great
you.
Great to see you.
And you?
Hi, Steve.
Are you as nervous as me?
Yes.
Probably.
Oh, right, OK.
Probably more.
Oh. Anyway, are you ready?
Yeah.
Jeez, look at that.
It's reborn.
That is absolutely fantastic. That is gorgeous. Am I allowed to have a quick peek inside?
Yes, carry on. It's yours.
Oh, I can't believe it's the same thing. Look how clean.
It's beautiful.
Well, it has to be clean and sparkly so it performs as it was originally intended and as your relatives once enjoyed it.
Yeah. Oh, look, it's got that on there. I didn't realise. It's got a pointer. And so that denotes which tune is playing.
That's right.
Now then, is it going
to... You know what to do, don't you?
Can I just...
Yeah.
Here we go. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
That's a zither. We didn't have that when you bought it
That's
in.
That's right.
Yeah.
So this is a product of my graveyard in the workshop. Basically, it's a gantry that supports a roll of tissue paper to give a particular musical effect.
Oh, okay.
This is a brilliant job, Steve. You really have done a fantastic job.
Thank you very much.
Can you imagine 1905 people sitting around the fireplace with this playing in the background?
That sort of brings a connection with your family, does it? The
very
fact
much
that
so.
They had this and you have it. Because of what we've done here, your family now will be hearing the same music as your family then. It's not a recording.
It is the actual.
This is the actual sound that your family then heard. So it's quite an interesting thought,
that
isn't it?
That is a very good thought. I tell you what, Steve, one of the things I wanted more than anything else was not to change it too much, because the scars, the damage, the bits and pieces, that's part of its history to me. I had hoped that it would look like this, but this is actually way beyond my expectation. It is fabulous.
Well, I'm pleased you're happy with the finish and the result.
I'm happy. It's brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you too.
I think you might have to drive because I'm going to be looking at this.
All right then.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the privilege of working on it. Thank you.
This is something I've anticipated a long, long time. And I don't think anything prepared me quite for what I saw. It was an emotional moment. It's something that binds you to the people who have gone before. If Mum was here now, knowing that we're all listening to something that she listened to when she was a little, 5 or 6 years of age, that will just bring a big smile to her face. As indeed it's going to bring a big smile to my face too.